Hi there, my name is Ron Rogers, and I'm going to tell you about the Boeing 757-300 flight evaluation that I performed. Now, if you've been following along with all my flight evaluations, and there have been quite a few of them, this is third from the end. I'm getting close to the end here. Technically, it's kind of second from the end because the last formal one I did as chairman of the Airworthiness Performance Evaluation and Certification Committee for ELPA was the 717. Now, Boeing, back then it was a whole different company. They, as a very nice thing, they allowed me to fly the Boeing 247, and I actually wrote an article about it, and it was kind of interesting. This is the first evaluation that I kind of did on my own, if you will. The other ones as chairman, I just wrote and published. This one, the ELPA magazine actually paid me for, which I thought was really, really interesting. All those, I could have made a fair amount of money if I gotten paid for all the rest of ones, but I didn't, and I digress. But anyway, okay, this flight evaluation. Now, the major thing about the Boeing 757-300 is it's a long aircraft. It's just a long aircraft. And at the time, now that previous slide, you saw United Airlines end up with the Continental merger. We ended up getting the 757-300s. But at the time, it was brand new. Now, one thing that Boeing does is they can't afford to have a, you know, airplane like a 777 or a 757 just sitting around. They basically have an agreement where they do all the required certification tests on a airplane that belongs to one of the airlines that's going to buy it. So, and we had to be kind of special on what we could do with this because they didn't want us to damage the engines and things like that, about getting aggressive on some of the maneuvers, stalls and stuff like that. Stalls can actually be pretty bad. The compressor section can actually end up rubbing against the cowling due to various aerodynamic forces that occur during a stall, and we could actually smell that. Actually, it came in where it ended up rubbing. We were trying to avoid that, but I remember getting on this Condor aircraft and looking down it, and the seats, it's all one class. They take people on vacations and that, so they pack them in, and this is all one class of service. And I mean, even if you look at a 757-300 to date, they go on forever. This was even worse with just all single class. It was like, you know, those mirror things where it keeps on going on forever. But yeah, this is a long aircraft. It was kind of like, you know, I joked with Boeing about the 737. Now they went up to the 67, 800, 900, and then they started calling them the Maxes and stuff. But I asked them, I said, you know, how far are you going to stretch this aircraft? Are you going to have a 737-1500 model that's longer than a 747 someday, and it's so long you can't even rotate? It just has to levitate off the runway. But yeah, anyway, I digress. All right, so let's talk about the evaluation there. And as you can see, that guy in the left seat there, that's me. Even though the hair color is a little off, that's me. And the guy behind me is Leon Robert, who is the chief test pilot on the 757-300 for Boeing. In the right forefront right there, that's Joe Kohler. Joe was a Northwest pilot who had been a longtime member of the committee. And kind of hidden there behind him is Harry Walker. Now, I'm going to do eventually a video on about all the absolutely fantastic people I had on my committee. And as we started doing these flight evaluations, getting publicity, I had a lot of really cool people apply, but I couldn't bring on some fantastic people, and I had to keep on some people who haven't been mentioned and won't be mentioned, but I had to keep on some people who were just dead weight, but they were there because of politics. Yeah, ALPA has politics, who knew? But anyway, I was not able to bring some of these people on, and I'm going to talk about them because some of them were absolutely fantastic. Now, Harry retired from the Air Force as a full bird colonel. He was group commander of Eglin, which is a test area in Florida there. They do a lot of the weapons stuff where we do the initial flight stuff at Edwards Air Force Base. But Harry had been an X-29 test pilot. So, and he had flown everything. I mean, just amazingly qualified guy. And the fun thing was, and I digress here slightly, the fun thing was we went to a Society of Experimental Test Pilots national convention they have out there in Los Angeles. And all these Air Force guys who knew Harry, because he had quite a reputation, come up. These are all test pilots who want to talk about being an airline pilot. And it really kind of shocked me because I thought, you guys are test pilots. Why do you care about being an airline pilot? But they understood the lifestyle was pretty good. And the unfortunate thing is, yeah, you go through test pilot school, but you're not going to end up doing the first flight on the X-35 necessarily, unless you really stand out and all this stuff. So a lot of people, not a lot of good jobs, and kind of, I guess for some of them, they just wanted to go on and do airline stuff, and a number of them did. But one thing interesting on this flight, they gave me, and they do that often, they give me some mementos, and I have a few of these. This was a envelope that was carried on the first flight of the 757-300, and a kind of funny thing is, until I did this video, I actually hadn't opened up the envelope and realized there was something inside, which had the specifications and information on the 757-300. So that was kind of interesting. But these were carried on it, and Boeing was kind enough to give me this, and I have some other ones from other flights too. But now to the article. Okay, this appeared in the Airline Pilot magazine, October 1999. Now, thing interesting, my son told me that 40% of the pilots at United Airlines have been hired since COVID. We're looking at 12,000 pilots. 40% of the people were hired in just the last few years. So I can pretty well attest that probably nobody at United Airlines, or for probably most of the airlines, has read any of my articles, because they're all retired now. These are, it's going on 25 years ago, so it's been a while. But this was when the airplanes were new. I mean, the 757-300, they're all over the place now. But this is back when they're new, and we were doing the initial evaluation. And there's my little green arrow that points to about middle of the line here. Didn't get on the cover there, but did get kind of middle mentioned there. All right, so as I said, the 757-300 is a long airplane. It kind of reminds me of the Stretch DC-8. Oh, and for those of you who want to read the article, I've attached it in the comments. You can download a PDF file. This aircraft, typical configuration, 250 seats. The Dash 300 is 23 feet, 4 inches longer than the Dash 200, and the same length as a 767-300. Now, one thing they did was they used the same engines. And of course, anybody who's on the 27, you know about the Stretched, and you make the airplane bigger, longer, and heavier, and you keep the same engines, and the performance can kind of suck. So, yeah, that's one thing that you're going with here, that you have a longer airplane, same engines, rated at 43,000 pounds of thrust. So obviously the performance will not be as impressive. And one of the big things on this is, being long, you got the whole tail strike issue. Now, they put one of these compressible canisters in the tail skid, and I actually knew a captain who hit the tail skid on a 27 and made the and of course the mechanics gave him the little thing partially crushed, and he made it into some sort of a lamp or something like that to honor the whole event. But some comparisons of the FAR takeoff field length for the 757-200, all parameters being the same, is, let's call it 67, 80 feet. And for the Dash 300, it's 76, 10 feet. So that is one of the issues that, having the same engines but higher gross weight, you're going to chew up more runway. The typical cruise speed on the Dash 300 will be 0.78 to 81, but because of its increased weight, it'll typically cruise an altitude between flight level 330 and 370, while the 200 usually cruise between 370 and 390. It's got the same tail clearance as the 767-300ER, but it's got, like I said, a tail skid there to kind of protect the thing, because you always got the option, I won't quite call it option, the danger of getting a tail strike on takeoff or landing, and I guess Boeing was so feeling this would be an issue that they made it very easily to change out this crushable canister, although it's not as easy to change out the crew having to talk to a flight manager about why you hit the tail skid. And just as for reference, the most severe possible encounter with tail skid clearance is an engine out takeoff with a 5-knot early rotation. You never want to rotate early on an engine out. Speed is life. And situation yields a 1 degree clearance in that case. So if you got an engine out situation, you rotate 5 knots early, you got 1 degree of clearance. And of course, we all know it's not hard to lose that 1 degree of clearance. And of course, San Francisco taking off on the ones, you had where you crossed the 2H, you had that little bump. And here now they've taken that bump out. But on the 727, if you weren't careful, you started the rotation there, typically on flaps 5. A lot of guys use 15 to avoid the issue. But if you use flaps 5, you started that rotation and you hit the bump, you could get that tail skid. It was kind of one of those gotchas. But normally tail skids are caused by rapid rotation. And in fact, some of the longer airplanes, after you rotate, they will actually print out what your rotation rate so you can see how you did. Kind of be careful there, Bucky. One of the things they try to do, they're trying to standardize it, keep the same type rating, all this stuff. So they're trying to make the same control forces during rotation. All right. Now, one thing that's kind of an interesting side note here is that the rotation, they have to decide where they are going to model the rotation rate. And so they do it. They figure the point is maximum takeoff gross weight. Well, they found it interesting that operators of the -300 operated about 20% less than the maximum takeoff gross weight. And they reported that the -300 feels heavier than the -200 in that situation. Now, there are a couple interesting aspects to the design of this aircraft. It had CRTs, cathode ray tubes, instead of the LCD displays. And they're kind of the older variety. And what Boeing actually did was they have a round dial airspeed indicator next to the PFD on the CRT there, which is kind of interesting. So you got two airspeed indicators, and the CRT is a little smaller than the later LCD, so a lot of stuff was kind of restricted, compacted, and that. And this was kind of a period of changeover to the more nicer displays we have now, and I mean some of the ones that take up all the space there in front and give you just a plethora of information are really amazing. It's nice how far things have come in a reasonably amount of time. Now, one thing I'd like to mention, the 767, the 757-300 uses for stall kind of information. It uses a elevator feel shift mechanism instead of a stick pusher for the stall recovery. Now what it does is as you start to get close to it, it changes the stick forces on the control column to from 30 pounds to 60 pounds of pull. So as you're getting in the stall, if you want to be in a stall, you really have to pull. It doesn't have the prohibitions like the Airbus does. No, one thing interesting, the TCAS went off on this flight, and it's a nice female voice on the Boeing aircraft, and Airbus uses a male voice. I wonder what those discussions were like in those meetings and stuff like that, but I digress. But anyway, to initiate this field shift, they have two AOA sensors, because if you have an error in one AOA sensor, you could have a problem, so they have to compare the two. It would have been real nice if on later Boeing aircraft design, some brilliant manager engineer had not decided that one AOA indicator was enough. That obviously led to all sorts of problems, as you know what I'm getting at there. Now, as I said, this was flight test, and one of the things we do in flight test, we get to do some stuff that doesn't get you in front of the chief pilot at attention. But we could do stuff like, of course, we did steep turns. That's fairly standard, although you do those in the simulator, not the aircraft. But because you don't do that type of training in the aircraft anymore. But we also do stalls, and we take a look at low speed handling. So we selected a minimum speed of 200 knots, 0.65 Mach at 390. Now, most 757 pilots, and I think most big airplane pilots, would feel rather uncomfortable at 200 knots at 390. But the auto throttle system acts as kind of a speed protection system, and it comes in there to prevent you from getting too slow. And one of the other things we get to do and have done on a number of flight tests is we can look at single engine performance, and we can look at single engine performance by actually shutting down one of the engines. So we're just operating on one engine. Again, flight test aircraft, and so we can get away with that. And of course, there are no passengers on board, which you know, is a reason why we can do that. But anyway, it allows us to get some very good data under conditions that we don't have to necessarily simulate. Now, here's a picture looking back, and it gets a little dark in the back because it just kind of goes on forever. But like I said, the seats in this airplane go on forever. And of course, you know, with all those seats and all those people, you're going to have a lot of doors and a lot of slides. And they were able to get, it wasn't a full passenger load, but they got everybody off after Delta had an engine problem on takeoff and had to abort. Now, this is why, you know, I always tell people, don't get it on an airliner with flip-flops. You never know what you're going to end up with, you know, out there. And I'm sure these people never expected to be out on the runway with snow and that. So, you always need to be prepared for an evacuation, although they're extremely minor. And of course, there is the United version that I flew on as a passenger. It's kind of funny. I was doing the standard space available thing, riding, you know, and we had a lot of seats on the airplane, and I was a little surprised because 757, I'm thinking a dash 200, and I hadn't realized it was a 300 we got from Continental. When I got on board and looked back, I go, oh yeah, this airplane goes on forever. There are a lot of seats. And of course, we're now flying it. I never had the opportunity to fly. Actually, I skipped over the 757, 767 operationally. I had this thing of, I would get on an aircraft in a seat and then not realize I had become senior. And when I was on the Airbus 320, I naturally assumed I'd go to the 5767, but I had the seniority actually to jump to the 777, so that's what I did for the last 13 years. And I checked out on the 777, the age 52, and my son, who I taught to fly, has just checked out in the 777 as captain at the age of 51. So it's kind of interesting. It's getting scary. But anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it, found it informative, and all that good stuff. Thanks for watching.